Okay, I was born on April 28th, 1923 in Pickens, South Carolina. I was raised around Greenville, South Carolina.
Was it a town or a farm or a city? What, describe where you were brought up, what it was like.
Country. And I was really brought up, we lived in an old Army camp, World War I Army camp, Camp Sevier, just outside of Greenville.
You know, in that era, I don't know, during the summers, things, when you reflect back when you were a kid in the summers, what did you do for fun during those periods?
Believe it or not, as I say, if it's Camp Sevier, an infantry training camp, and a lot of the trenches, the caves, and everything, the dugouts were still there, and I used to go up and play in those things when I was a kid. So I got a little bit of inspiration out of that from a military standpoint, you know. And it went for miles and miles. It's a huge place.
Was it kind of an outdoor childhood? You know what I mean?
More or less.
Were you the kind of kid that liked school?
No.
You know, when you do walk into a classroom full of kids, there's the full spectrum of personalities. There's the quiet kid, there's the loud kid, the joker, the prankster, the smart kid. If we'd walked into your school, your classroom, which kid were you?
I was the kid that would catch someone leaning back on a straight chair and kick a chair out from under, you know. But anyhow, let me describe my school to you. Back in those days, we did not have air conditioning. And it was a three-story building. And so you had to keep all of the windows and doors and things open to get the ventilation. And occasionally someone would get called down to the principal office to get a little discipline, and you hear the smacks all over the schoolroom, including George McKee's smack. I made a few trips to the principal office. And that big board he had, he'd probably electrocute him today for things that he did to the students, but it was effective. He got our attention.
Did the Depression affect your family?
Yeah, we were affected by that area. I don't know how many of these people around here wore hand-me-down clothing from the Depression, but the shoes I used to get had a hole in the end of the tennis shoe or something, you know, my big brothers had worn a hole in it, but it was that tough. It was tough times.
You know, when you look back on your childhood, and these were tough times, but when you look back on it now, did you like your childhood?
I have a strange philosophy, I guess, that everything that happened to me from childhood on up to this day seemed like a stepping stone, one thing to the next, makes it just better. So I don't have any complaints about my childhood, about my growing, about my military career, military assignments. Incidentally, so far as military assignments are concerned, this is a true fact, I never sought an assignment or an effective. Just do the best you can, and the bosses will recognize it, and put you where they want you to go. And that was the way I went through my career. Okay, I always wanted to fly, and I know that my family was not going to be able to send me to college because we had a pretty good-sized family just after the Depression, and we're not an affluent family, but there was one way you could enlist in the Army, Air Corps, Army at the time. And after a couple of years, took a equivalency examination, which I did, and for the cadet, aviation cadet program. So that was my plan to go get my wings, and that's what we did.
You know, before you went into the service, had you ever been in an airplane?
Oh, yeah. How much time do I have?
Well, it's interesting because most guys that we've talked to that went into the Army Air Corps had never been in an airplane before, but you had actually been in an airplane.
I started flying at age 14, and we started in a little G3 Piper Cub, and I was taking lessons, and this instructor told me, said, "Say, George, said, we've got some Miami air races in 1938, we're talking about now, going on in Miami, Florida." He said, "If you will rent the airplane, I will solo you on that trip down there before we get back home again. Guff Oil Company gave us all free aviation for the small aircraft, so all I had to do was to rent an airplane and had the instructor and everything. So we flew down to the Miami air races and came back and swear soloed. But that flight, I got so tired of flying, I didn't fly again for 2 years. Plane was just slow and the seat was hard. But
you were drawn to the flying, though.
Yeah. I used to hear an airplane coming when I was a young kid, and I just sit standing there and watch it go by, you know. Okay, I enlisted on 12 December 1940 in the U.S. Army Air Corps. And so I was enlisted status to start with there and went to the Aviation Cadet Program from that point. But before the Aviation Cadet Program, I was an instructor in the Airplane Mechanics Course at Chenewville, Illinois for a couple of years. Then I went to the Cadet Program. From there, I was commissioned in Moody Field, Georgia, second lieutenant. And, you know, because I was tracking at a pretty young age. I was not even 21 when I got my commission, and I thought I'd probably get a commission as a warrant officer or something. But lo and behold, for some reason, I got a second lieutenant commission. And so that was a good break for me.
How did you do as far as the flight training? You'd already had experience flying an airplane in civilian life. Take us through the flight training that you received.
Okay, first, of course, was the primary flight training, and that was at Lakeland, Florida. And PT-17s was the type of aircraft that flew. And when they said, I'll relate to you on windy March day, we went out to an auxiliary field, and the truck said, okay, so go ahead and take it around the field, I'm going to solo it. Boy, the wind was blowing hard. And my wife was working at that school as a ground mechanic at the time. She was just out of high school, and that's what all the young people did. When the war came out, they'd go to work someplace, you know. She was working there. And what I'm leading up to a story here, it's not true, but I'll tell it anyway. But anyhow, I ground looped this airplane on a solo flight and bent the wing, you know, wingtip. And so we had to wait for someone to come to fly it back. And I would always tell the story, Nikki, my wife, you know, she gave me such a hard time over the mirror to get her off my back. I broke one of her airplanes. So. And from there we went to basic Bainbridge, Georgia, and on over to Moody Field, Belasse, Georgia, where I graduated.
Proud day when you got the wings?
It was a proud day, but once again, there was no other one there for my family when I graduated. They couldn't, you know, wartime, travel restricted, gasoline restriction, rationing, all those things. But it was still a proud day.
Did you marry before the war or after the war?
I married after the war.
Oh, okay.
After I graduated from pilot training, I was assigned to Sebring, Florida to learn to fly B-17s. And so while I was there, I went back up to where Nikki was working, Lakeland, Florida. It was only about 60 miles away. And that's where we really started up our courtship, and we got married after that.
What was it about Nikki you were attracted to, when you think back on it?
She's just a beautiful person, young lady. That's her right there. She looked like Ginger Rogers.
Yes.
And a very charming young person.
Well, you got the wings. Where did it go from there? And your flight? Were you disappointed that you were moved into heavy bombers, or you had a view that maybe you were going to become a fighter pilot? I mean, where did you see it going?
That was my choice, bombers.
Why did you choose bombers?
I hate to make any confessions in this tape here, but I was subject to headaches, a migraine-type headache, and sometimes my vision would become affected. If from experience, and they, hey, you ought to be flying an airplane when someone's with you in case you have this problem. So I selected multi-engine aircraft. So that's why I went into the bomber B-17, so that was my choice.
How was the B-17, say, compared to other aircraft to fly? What was your experience with that airplane?
I heard them talking last night how difficult it was to fly that airplane, but I thought it was the easy, beautiful flying airplane. I didn't have any complaints about it. I was just real proud of that old bird, and it did a job for us, you know. Took me and my crew through 35 missions, not a scratch on us. 108 days, and we were back home, you know. And I'm going to give you a little story from B-17 transition. We went 12 miles north to Avon Park, Florida. And that's where we got the crew came together. We formed at Avon Park, Florida. And that's where Manny and DePierce were, and all the other ones, we got on the crew there. And I was selected as a pilot. And my co-pilot, God bless him, was a 29-year-old guy who went through OCS. And when I graduated, the crewman crew for the needed co-pilots. And Doug Grant became a co-pilot. Great guy. And so we had a good crew. Mm-hmm. But at Avon Park, to tell you a little story, we were getting ready to go overseas. They restricted everyone from the base, to the base rather. And there's about three of us who lived in Sebring and said, we've got to get down no telephone calls, nothing. So after dark, we went out and waded across this creek that was by the gate down there. Got on the highway and hitchhiked down to Sebring, Florida. And years later, I went back to that same river and shined my flashlight down the river. It was full of alligator eyes, you know. We didn't know what we were wading through, really. But it was just another life experience.
How did your crew, at least in the beginning, during the crew training, how did everybody coalesce?
Real well. The officers lived in VOQs, of course, and the airmen enlisted, they had their separate areas. And Doug Grant, he was married at the time, he was the only married person on the crew. And so we came together pretty well as a team.
Anything unusual, anything stand out in your mind during that training period while you were still over here in the U.S.?
Yeah, I recall one landing I made in a B-17 one night. And when we landed, we didn't even know we were on the ground. It was so smooth. And the instructor engineer was, boy, that was great. And the instructor pilot said, it wasn't so good. But it was one thing I recall, that landing in a B-17 and the mission, one of the missions where we flew, and when at that time my hand was so tired from gripping my throttles that I couldn't close my hands. But otherwise, it was a good old airplane. We were going to fly out of Savannah, Georgia, and B-17 became grounded. So after we were processed at Savannah, we went up to New Jersey and caught the Queen Elizabeth. We went across the Queen Elizabeth. So I was on the Queen with 13,000 other guys, and Joe Lewis was on board with us also. That's the only ocean cruise I've ever taken.
And you know, that's so many guys on that, on a ship like that, heading over to a war zone. Anything stand out in your mind when you think back on that, being on that boat going over?
The Queen was fast, so she outran the convoy that she was in, so we went ahead and did a lot of zigzagging to avoid the submarines. And the only thing that stood out in my mind, the officers, they had a converted stateroom. There'd be about 6-8 of us assigned to a stateroom and double deck bunks and everything. And the enlisted people, they had to sleep in shifts, downstairs and up on the deck, you know. So that was one thing that stood in my mind.
How'd you occupy your time? Or how'd you pass the time, do you remember, on the boat?
On the ship? I don't recall anything that I did. I know a lot of people made a lot of money on that trip. A lot of gambling and things, but I never gambled, so I didn't become rich off the trip to England. Well, we arrived in the UK, and a trainload of us, and we were put on trucks, and that's where my friend Manny Banner, we had a British band out welcoming, you know, part of welcome someone. Well, Manny got out there leading the band, marching like James Cagney, just like I told you, you know, he was a character. And from there we went down in a truck to Framlingham. Tom Jeffers, who was the squadron exec officer, not squadron, but group exec officer at the time, he met us when we got there at daylight. My first exposure to 3-9, and Tom Jeffers, who was one of our leaders and later became the commander of the 100th Bomb Group. And he was my first contact.
When you arrived at the base at Framlingham, what did it look like? How, do you remember what your impression was at the time?
I really didn't have an impression. We were pretty tired, pretty fatigued, and I was just looking for a bunk assignment.
And where did you live? I mean, what were the living conditions?
We lived in a Quonset hut with two other crews. And so all of my officers were located in the one Quonset hut. And the enlisted people, they had their own area they were living in. Just iron bunks, his famous British biscuit mattress, you know, three of them would make a match.
Could you stay warm in those Quonset huts?
I don't recall it getting too chilly. Of course, my tour was from April until August, so it was not cold weather at the time.
Did the training continue once you got over there?
We had about a 2 weeks training period after we arrived there, the orientation top flights. So we completed that, and during that time period, my ball turret gunner, OK Winters, who was really the oldest guy on the crew, 37-year-old Staff Sergeant Barber from St. Louis, Missouri, they put him on another crew as a substitute ball turret gunner, and the crew was lost. So OK was the only guy that I really lost, but I was not with him at the time that he went down, of course, but he didn't make it. So
you were assigned a new ball turret gunner?
Yes.
Was it strange bringing sort of an outsider into this, this close group of guys?
No, the outsider that I brought in, his name was Parasino. He was another New Yorker, and as New Yorkers, you know, they can work with themselves into anything. And he and Manny became great friends because he was on a crew previous to that. And for some reason, or other, he was working in the base photo lab. And I don't know if Manny gave you any pictures or not, but he came through Parasino.
In the training that continued and getting checked out once you got over there, do you remember who checked you out? Who?
I don't recall, really.
Or what kind of training was emphasized? Was it close formation flying?
Formation flying and forming, taking off, forming, to get the group formed up, you know, and things of that nature.
Were you comfortable with the idea? Maybe give us a short paragraph on what close formation flying is, why it was important, you know, sort of how that worked.
Well, it, of course, it's a skill that you develop, I guess, or a strong good, one of the two. I don't know, some guys couldn't get it close enough, but during the missions, the Germans would be jamming us, you know, with their radar and the things. And he got where the thing was talking to me. It went ever sitting closer. So I just took my wing a little closer, and that's what we would do.
And the advantage of close formation flying, what was that?
Firepower. Mutual support firepower. And the German fighters could not fly between the formations.
How many missions did you fly?
35.
And you're not going to obviously remember all those missions, but were there missions for one reason or another that stood out in your mind?
Well, the first two missions were sort of milk runs, fairly close, short ones. The third mission was to Berlin. And the thing that stood out in my mind there was the day after I became 21 years old.
You know, could you, you know, the Berlin missions, the Big B. Can you take us through sort of a mission? That is to say, you know, they woke you up in the morning and, you know, and sort of take us through that mission.
Well, it's the same routine every time, depending on where you're going, what time they'll wake you up. Normally around 2 or 3 o'clock in the morning. And you go from there to breakfast, have breakfast, to the briefing room where if you had a general briefing, the crew would break up into specialized briefing with the navigator, the bombardier. The gunners were generally going out to the aircraft, start preparing the airplane with their part of the responsibilities. And then we would, after the briefing, would go out to the aircraft and stand down in our stand for several minutes, for maybe an hour or something like that, and then we would fire it up and take off.
As a pilot, once you got out into the, you know, actually let me back up, in the briefing room as a pilot, what was going on in the briefing?
Well, you would have, normally the group commander would get up with a few opening remarks, and after that would be the intelligence officer briefing you what the mission consists of and the hazards around the target.
Would they have the big map?
And they had big map and the string stretch across the board.
When you got out as a pilot out to the hard stand, what were you usually doing at that point?
Well, I would had my pre-flight responsibilities, things I'd go through in pre-flight when we aircraft, and after that I sort of touch base with the rest of the crew members, see if everything was going well, and then they would take a break, smoke or something, and tell a story that before each mission I'd go over the edge of the hard stand, talk to the man up above, you know, ask for a safe return or something, and I think he listened to me on each mission because we went through 35, not a scratch on anyone.
Talk about the takeoff. You know, this is a huge bomber with 9 guys on there, full of bombs and full of gasoline. Taking off a lot of times in English fog, what's it like taking off and with all those planes?
Yeah, I don't recall taking off without that English fog. You know, it's always a cloud, overcast or something, and you have to fly through the clouds to form up, and you go out on a certain heading up to 12,000-13,000 feet and make a turn and do another, pick up another heading, and flying in those clouds, you know, you'd run across prop wash, shaking you up, and say, where's that guy at? And how close am I? And that's one of the amazing things to me was that we did not have more mid-air collisions over there on the assemblies.
I think you mentioned that the Berlin mission was one mission that stood out in your mind. Take us through that mission, why it stands out in your mind.
The only reason it did, because I say it was the day after I was 21 years old. Otherwise, it was just another mission. I guess the mission is stands out most is one of the Brooks, Czechoslovakia, and because it was a long, tiring mission. And on that particular mission, I was flying in the slot on the lead element, and flying close as you could, you get in the prop wash of the lead aircraft. And I think it was fighting prop wash more than anything else. Trying to stay close.
And prop wash is turbulence caused by another aircraft.
That's correct, yeah. Okay. And I did not drop down low enough, so that was when I said I landed, I couldn't close my fist because, you know, holding the B-17 throttle to the pilot does it like that. And so that was a story on that.
Did you have a routine with your co-pilot, sort of trading off, or how did the two of you coordinate with each other?
We did. We had a routine when we could. On that particular mission, I had a substitute co-pilot, Joe Walters, who later became the squadron commander over there. And so he would fly some. He was an extremely good pilot also. Joe Walters was. Doug Grant didn't go with me on that one. But when Doug and I would fly together, depending on where you were in the formation, and I flew quite a few half squadron leads, and if you fly a half squadron lead, you cannot you know, you got to be able to look down, and duck sitting up in the right seat, you could look down and see the formations. So on that type of a formation assignment, I couldn't let duck fly as much as I wanted to.
How do you handle the fatigue on such, on those, especially the one you just described, Czechoslovakia? That is a long mission.
You handle it by being 20 years old, 21 years old, and just went with that, you know. Just like Mola was saying, I thought he gave a very good talk at the dinner last night. But when you got through speaking, I told the fellow sitting next to me, there was no hero, sir. It was just a job. You had to go out and do a job, and that's what we did.
Were there, you certainly described more than a taxing mission there, all the way to Czechoslovakia. Were there other missions for one reason or another, the target, flak, fighters, an unusual experience, something that stands out in your mind as far as other missions?
Yeah, my three most favorite missions were my last three. And that was on a second shuttle run to Russia. And so...
Tell us about the shuttle missions, what those were, where you went.
Okay, we went and we bombed Gdynia, Poland, on the way over to the base there in Russia, landed to Russia, and because I, at that time I had 33 missions and I needed my airplane for another crew to fly, I did not fly out of Russia, my crew did not, because I was already up to the max mission number almost, so they put someone else in my airplane. And then the next day we flew down to Foggia, Italy, bombing Palestri on our way down. Spent a couple of 3 days in Foggia, Italy, then bombed the target in France on the way back to England. And that was my last mission, and in fact I've got the photograph of it here.
Oh.
Four of us finishing up there.
In front of the plane.
Yeah.
That's the Pierce brothers, you and...
my radio operator. And you say, where are the other guys? Well, you know, there you'd catch cold, get the sniffles or something, so they'd go on a sick call, so they didn't go fly a mission that day or something. So a few of them came up a few short when the four of us finished. And I had one waist gunner who is deceased now, but a couple, 3 years ago, the Kansas City Star interviewed him. And he was telling about the missions and how afraid he was and everything like that. So I wrote him a nice letter and I said, gee, if only were that scared, afraid, why didn't you come up front with us? We weren't afraid up front, you know. But he was a great guy.
When you did fly that last mission, I don't know, I picture champagne, hurrahs, buzzing the field. I mean, was there any kind of eventful thing you did?
No Memphis Belle trips, tricks rather. But I will tell you one thing, I did fly the Memphis Belle several times. After it completed its bond tour, they signed it to McDill Field, where we used it as a crew training airplane. In fact, I took my wife up in it. At that time, you could take your dependence up for, I think it was about 30 minutes every 6 months or something. That's one of the perks you had. So we flew up into Memphis Belle, and a bunch, several of the instructor pilots and the wives around Tampa there.
In those 35 missions, you saw a lot of pilots. I mean, there were a lot of B-17s in the 390th. And you had quite a bit of experience. Describe an ideal B-17 pilot to me. What characteristics typified a good pilot?
George McKee. No, really, a lot of guys who, you know, spend a lot of time in the officers' club and things like that, which I did not do. And we all had personal things that we wanted to do, you know, and so a lot of the Framlingham and to the pubs and so forth, but I hung fairly close to the base, and being an old enlisted mechanic, I'd go down and work for the crew chief, hang around the airplane quite a bit, and so it was pretty much the way it was.
Even at that young age, you had a certain professionalism about you. Where did that come from?
Came from my early enlisted days, and I was very competitive, and And there's nothing that we would like more than a standby inspection, footlocker inspection in the barracks, you know, competing with the other guys. See who could show off the footlocker the best and the clothes and all this stuff. And that's the way I was throughout my Air Force career. I was extremely competitive. And, well, we're on that point, I'll give you a little bit of my philosophy. I always felt, and this is true back then, that you became part of the mission and the mission became part of you. You can't separate them. That's even true in the business world if you're a successful businessman. And so that's what I practiced throughout my life and what I still practice today. And whatever you're doing, do it to the best of your ability. You know?
Where did that come from in you? Is your background a relative, innate?
I really don't know, but I know when I went through high school, I was sort of a class leader or something, you know. And I had my own little A-model Ford. I would run up down the dirt roads. So it always sort of a class leader back in those days. It seemed like it carried over into service.
I do want to ask you a couple more questions about missions because, you know, you got, as you've said, you got through without a scratch, but I do not want to leave any viewer with the idea that these were somehow just all milk run type of missions. There were missions involving flak.
Everything. Sometimes a flak cloud would be so thick out there, you know, you think you're flying through a cloud. It's just the flak smoke and everything. As I said, the good man above was not watching after me, I think, because I talked to him from the heart stand each morning before we went off on a flight. And so I was just extremely fortunate. And, you know, I read these stories, these horror stories in these books, like The Selling Downstairs, and I've read all of them. And those guys had a rough time. And I don't know why. We slipped through like a greased pig, you know, no problems at all.
Did your leadership with professionalism and discipline must have played some part, though, in it, as far as coming through without that scratch? Certainly luck, I suppose, plays into it, but what do you attribute it to?
Well, I think I'll go back to your first point, 90% luck. We came back with a lot of holes in the aircraft, but the flak did not contact any of the crew members, no injuries or anything. But I just can't contribute to anything else other than luck and the good gracious of the Lord above, and I go from that point.
Once you had completed your 35 missions, did you go home immediately, or did you stay there at some point? Or?
No, we went to Miami Beach, Florida, to Rehabilitation Center. And my wife, she was 8 months pregnant when we went down there. And she came, and you go there for 2 weeks, normally it's there for 2 weeks. And she came down with uremic poisoning, and so they had to admit her to the hospital. I was getting ready to be dismissed, and so I said, hey, I've got to figure out somewhere to stay here until she gets out of the hospital. So I asked some of those professionals who had been there a couple, 3 months or more. I said, how do you guys get to stay this long? They said, well, when a psychiatrist come around, tell me you wake up at night screaming, or you see a B-17 going down through the emotions, you know, and you say, bail out. So I did that. So they extended my stay. The only problem is, Nick came up for dismissal from the hospital, and I was stuck there. I couldn't get out. So there was another crisis for us, but I talked my way out of that. They assigned us to McDill Field in Tampa, Florida, as a B-17 instructor for the combat crews going to combat over there. And later we converted to B-29s, and when we separated in the war, I was flying B-29s.
Take us through sort of your military career.
At the end of the war, I recognized, you know, there were a couple hundred thousand of officers or something in the military, and they all were going to be getting out. And so, of course, my enlisted time, I had accumulated some points and a few decorations. I had points from that, so had a number of points where I could be one of the first guys to be separated in September 1945. And I recognized that I had a wife, a child that's less than a year or so old, and I had to get out and go and get that college degree. So I got out to go to college. College, getting into college, no problem. But there was a nationwide policy at the time, the people who were in the military, the employers were going to save their job until they came back, you know, those who had been drafted. And that's what I ran up against when I got out. I couldn't get a decent job because all the good jobs were being saved for the fellows who were still in the military had not come home yet. So because of that, well, the military came up with a policy at that time that if you were former commissioned officer, you could re-enlist again as a master sergeant, or you could re-enlist as master sergeant. And I'd been an NCO before, so I know what type of life that was. It was not a bad life, really. And at that point, though, you had to be a staff sergeant before you could get married. They wouldn't let you get married before you were a staff sergeant. But anyhow, I recognized it was a good chance for a second career, fairly good income, to take care of Nikki and the baby, and so I enlisted. And I'm probably one of the few guys who was commissioned from an NCO status twice. I was commissioned from NCO status from a cadet, and then when I went back in, I enlisted as a master sergeant, and I was commissioned with that, and a little experience with that one. I was up at Chinook Field, where I had spent a couple of 3 years as an instructor up there, and I knew a lot of the guys who came back there after the war. A lot of good friends, buddies up there. So, the War Department sent a message to my home in Greenville, South Carolina, telling me to report to a screening board at Fort Benning, Georgia. And it got to me late, and those guys, they did all they could to get me off on time on the bus to go down to Fort Benning. So we did that, and I went before the screening board. And there was one officer there, a ground officer, I guess. He said, how do you think you can compete with the academy graduate? You know, you don't have any college degree or anything. I said, well, you start us off at the same time and I'll get there whenever you get there. And we got into a hell of an argument. I thought I'd rip my britches. And coming out, the escort officer said, how'd you do? I said, I think I ripped it. He said, why is that? I told him, he said, you did one of the best jobs I've seen in a That's where it goes, you know. Well, I was very fortunate, as I told you, I never worked for a job or an assignment or an effectiveness report. You just do the best you can and you get the recognition. And although I spent quite a few years in the second bomb wing, 8 years in fact, in the same bomb squadron after the war, flew a crew for 4 more years, squadron operational for 2 years, squadron commander for 2 years. And then I was reassigned to SAC headquarters as a command, as a project officer at the SAC command control system. I spent 5 years in that job, and I recognized it was going to take another 5 years to sort of complete it. So I asked to be, my assignment to be terminated there, and I went to Spain as the base commander in Spain for 3 years. Back to the Industrial College in Washington for 1 year, and then a series of command assignments there, which commanded three B-52 wings, an air division, an 8th Air Force, and then my final assignment was out here at Randolph as Commander Air Training Command. And one of the high points of my career, I guess, was a change of command at Guam, on Guam, when I assumed command of the 8th Air Force. One thing that I'm sort of proud of, I think I was probably one, if not the only, combat crew member who later made that circuit and became commander of the 8th Air Force, you know. I don't know anyone else who did that. And, but anyhow, we had General R. Aker there, General Little was there, and all of the former 8th Air Force commander. So that was really a high point in my career to be there with all those great heroes of mine in the past. They were some great, great guys. We showed them a good time over there. So that was one of the high points.
Where do you, proud of your time in the 390th?
Oh yes, very much so.
And tell me why is that?
Well, it was just a fine organization, had a great record, and I don't feel that I contributed anything to that record because we went through the east and everything, but some of the guys gave so much to the 390th. Guys like I mentioned, Tom Jeffers, Bill Pennebaker, and the other people who were quite senior to me when I went through the there as a combat crew member, as a pilot on the B-17. And just a good group of staff people there. I did not know Colonel Joe Moeller there because I left before he arrived. And later, though, we met. I went to a reunion in Orlando, Florida, where he was 393 Union. Of course, he was principal speaker. And he gave such a great speech. I said, that's my kind of guy there. So we became friends after that. He and Dorothy, just a close relationship. Not because of my time with the 390th, but he was just a fine person. She was, too.
Were you proud of your crew?
Extremely proud of my crew. Because they were not troublemakers. You know, they were all pretty good guys. The Pierce brothers from Connecticut, and my other gunner, he was from Kansas. And my tail gunner, he was a Mormon from Utah. And instantly, he was the only virgin on the crew. Rest of us were married. They had a lot of girlfriends in England, one or two, you know. So it was just a good group of guys. Night we got married, Nick and I got married. Next morning I called home to tell my family that they thought I was going to be a bachelor all my life. And I told her, I had to call home, the call may come through while I'm going down to get some coffee. And sure enough, that call came through and my dad answered the phone. And she said, this is Nicky, George's wife. And he said, the hell do you say? And that was her greeting to the family. You know, that was always humorous to us.
Why do you think they thought you'd always be a bachelor?
Oh, that's the way they had me pegged.
And how many years were you married?
We were married when we were 20 years old. She was 20 and I was 20, so 62 years. And she passed away before I'm living with Alzheimer's disease.
What's the secret to having 62 years of marriage?
Incompatibility. When I was young, I was a stutterer. Certain words I could not say, and I even have that problem today. In my last job as the governor's social chairman, I wanted to go down to the congressional hearings for my budget and things, and you sort of get up tight for some reason, and the words won't come out. And that was one of the problems, and because I always avoided making speeches, because I knew that I'd have a problem delivering certain things. So I never made many speeches because of that. I was never necessarily a good speaker, and so that was one of the things. Really, I wanted to become a control tower operator in between my military enlisted assignments, but I couldn't because I would stutter. And I'd start talking on the radio and you start stuttering, and it wouldn't work. So that's when I continued in the airplane mechanics business.
Well, it certainly didn't hold you back.
Well, I was quite proud of one thing. One of my proudest publications that my name appeared in was down at Eglin Field, Florida. Have a base paper, and the article came out, 29 officers and one master sergeant received federal commission. And that's one of my proudest publications that I have in my files now at home. And when we were at the Soldiers' Airmen's Home, we were there for 12 years. And what that place is in, well, at that time, it's enlisted retirement home, enlisted people. They had 2,200 enlisted retirees there. And so we had to provide them accommodations, food, place to live, and everything. And it was my mission in during that 12 years to take care of those people, which we did. And Nikki was quite involved, in fact. A chapel, some of the sanctuary, they named in her memory, because she could. contributed so much to get the place, as what you see in that picture right there, a stained glass windows for the place, which we got from Westover Air Force Base. It was closed down there, chapel, and it converted to a child care center, and a retired group of people. They were concerned those windows going to get broken, and what those windows were, when they lose a combat crew or some people up there, they would dedicate a stained glass window in their memory. And I was afraid they were going to lose it because it was a child care center. So Nick and I went up there, Chicopee Falls, Massachusetts, and talked them in, letting us have those windows, which they did, and we installed them into our chapel down at in Washington. You know, one of the most beautiful military top chapels you'd ever see. Right?
Even in retirement, you and Nicky didn't get out on rocking chairs on the porch. You know, why was that? As a couple, you apparently stayed pretty active. I mean, you had, why was that?
I don't know, it's such as flowing in your blood. You know, it's, and we were fairly young, really. I retired when I was 51 years old. Out here, at Randolph is where I retired from, and she was quite young, I was quite young, and we had life ahead of us. And I got out, did not want to become associated with a defense-oriented type of industry, anything like that. And finally, the Air Force headquarters called me and said, hey, we've got this job to become available at Soldiers' Nurses' Home. Are you interested? And I said, let me check it. So I went up there on the 4th July weekend, 1978, and I scouted it for 3 days. And the more I looked, the more I saw, more of a challenge that I could see there, so I applied for it and got the job. Appointment by, it was a small government agency, and the appointment of President Carter, reappointed by President Reagan and President Bush, which was 12 years worth of time there. Greatest job, and I hate to say this, but it's a better job than I had in the military, more satisfying.
Why was that?
Because I was doing stuff for the troops, taking care of 2,200 retirees there, and we made a lot of great improvements there. And one thing that in 1953, the Comptroller General made a decision that the fines and forfeitures from Article 15, which was a form of punishment in the military, the money would not come to the home. And so that was one of the first challenges to get that done, which we did, and once we did that, it gave us an additional $17 million a year income, and we made a lot of improvements on things that have been deferred over the years, including that chapel and air conditioning all of the rooms, and coming up with single rooms, single baths with people living there. So.
When you look back, was it a good life?
Oh, yeah. As I said in the beginning, everything I've done in life is just like a set of stair steps. One thing looked like it leads to the other one. That's where it was planned, you know. So I have no complaints about life.